By now, I think we all know about SpaceX and Blue Origin's ambitions to create a reliable satellite internet service. SpaceX has already launched thousands of Starlink satellites, and they are currently in the process of rolling out a beta version. Meanwhile, Blue Origin slash Amazon seems to be years behind, as they haven't even reached orbit yet. Considering either company's situations, people love to make fun of Blue Origin for making very minimal progress. But what's ironic is that both SpaceX and Blue Origin are decades late to the game. As Bill Gates was trying to launch his own satellite internet service called Teledesic way back in the early 1990s. So here's a story of the time Bill Gates tried to launch his own Starlink, but unfortunately failed. Teledesic was originally founded in June of 1990 by business mogul Craig McCaw. Craig had previously hit it big with his company McCaw Cellular, which was a leader within the cellular telephone market. His father had actually founded the company way back in 1966 as a cable television provider, and though he did find a good amount of success within that industry, it wasn't until Craig shifted the focus of the company to the cellular market that they became a major player. AT&T would end up buying McCaw Cellular for $12.6 billion in 1993, making Craig a billionaire. So clearly, Craig was not messing around when it came to Teledesic. He was previously able to identify an upcoming boom within the cellular market, which made him a billionaire. And now, he aimed to do the exact same thing with the satellite internet market. The first couple of years were pretty slow, as Craig was still very much focused on McCaw Cellular. But after the acquisition in 1993, Craig would turn his full focus onto Teledesic, and he would onboard a notable partner, which was of course, Bill Gates. In 1994, both Craig and Bill Gates would invest $5 million into the company. And with that, Craig would begin to pitch the idea to countries and companies around the world. But wait a minute, both Craig and Bill were billionaires with an abundance of connections within the business world. So why did they need to raise money and bring on investors? Well, similar to Elon's vision with Starlink today, Craig's vision was simply so massive that even two billionaires couldn't handle it by themselves. You see, Craig wasn't looking to launch 10 or 20 satellites. No, he wanted to launch 840 satellites. At the time, this was more than the total number of satellites in space, and accordingly, it came with a hefty setup cost of $9 billion. Though the project was extremely expensive, it promised to make internet access basically universal. No matter how remote a location was, people could use Teledesic services. Given the company's vision and the people behind the company, many investors would give the company a shot. Boeing would pledge to invest up to $100 million. Saudi Prince Al-Waleed bin Talal would invest $200 million, and Motorola would invest a massive $750 million. Ironically, the company had no working product, but it was able to raise nearly $2 billion, mostly because Bill Gates and Craig McCaw were involved. Aside from raising a crap ton of money, Bill and Craig were even able to convince governments to set aside a portion of the electromagnetic spectrum that would be exclusively used by Teledesic's network. Clearly, Bill and Craig were not messing around, and now it was time to execute. The duo was very much aware of how important execution was, so they chose the best partner they could, which was of course, Boeing. Boeing was given most of the responsibility of designing the satellites, building the satellites, and launching the satellites. Boeing already had extensive experience working on space projects, so this project was a piece of cake for them. Teledesic's proposed satellites were super small and didn't have to be launched that far into space. So, Boeing planned to simply launch clusters of satellites on large existing boosters, which is not that different from Starlink missions today. While Boeing was working on developing Teledesic satellites, the relatively small Teledesic team of 100 employees focused on getting regulatory approval and hitting other technical requirements. Everything seemed to be quickly progressing forward, but this is when Teledesic would face its first major setback. As we previously discussed, Teledesic wanted to launch 840 super small satellites, but Boeing insisted on launching fewer, larger satellites. Given that Boeing was Teledesic's primary contractor at this point, Teledesic would agree and reduce the proposed number of satellites to just 300. The official explanation for the switch was that Boeing's proposed plan was superior to Teledesic's original idea. However, a former employee of Teledesic would eventually reveal in 2016 that this explanation was a complete lie. The primary reason Boeing insisted so heavily on launching larger satellites is because legacy satellite manufacturers already had large satellites in inventory. Now, manufacturing smaller satellites like Teledesic wanted wouldn't be that hard for them, but the manufacturers were heavily opposed to this idea. You see, these traditional satellite manufacturers had a monopoly within the industry, and it was nearly impossible for a startup to compete against them as the bar for entry was so high. However, if these manufacturers expanded to producing smaller satellites, the bar for entry would be significantly lowered, which could lead them to losing market share to startups. Aside from this, the manufacturers were also fearful that if they started to produce smaller satellites, the US military would also prefer to buy the smaller ones, which had much lower profit margins. So, basically, Teledesic was forced to switch to larger satellites because satellite manufacturers didn't want to let go of their monopoly. We're not exactly sure how much these larger satellites cost, but assuming that the cost to launch all the satellites was constant at $9 billion, each satellite cost approximately $30 million. To put this in perspective, Starlink satellites are expected to cost $250,000 per satellite and already cost less than $500,000 per satellite. Starlink satellites are more comparable to the smaller satellites Teledesic wanted to launch, but even then the cost per satellite is insanely high. If we spread the $9 billion over 840 satellites like originally anticipated, we get nearly $11 million per satellite, which is over 20 times the cost of a Starlink satellite today. And the truth is, satellite costs have not dropped 20-fold over the past two decades. So, Teledesic was more or less getting ripped off when it came to launching satellites. Aside from getting ripped off, major red flags started to pop up that people weren't actually that interested in a satellite-based internet service. In 1999, two satellite companies named Iridium Communications and ICO would file for bankruptcy. These guys weren't targeting the satellite internet market, but they were targeting the satellite phone market. At first glance, you might think that maybe they ran out of funding or that investors backed away. However, this was actually still before the dot-com crash, so funding wasn't that hard to secure. The real problem with these companies was that there was very little demand for their services. The only people buying their services were people working on fishing boats and people working on oil rigs. Let's also keep in mind that during this time period, having a cell phone connection was a much higher priority than having an internet connection. So, if these cell phone companies couldn't find much demand, it was unlikely that Teledesic would find much demand with the internet. And this does make sense. Providing internet to every corner of the world is a very noble cause. But how many people living in rural villages in the late 1990s wanted to access internet, had a device that could access internet, and could afford to pay for a monthly internet subscription? From an outside perspective, it's pretty clear why there was lackluster demand, but Craig didn't really see this side of the picture. In fact, he actually thought that the bankruptcies of Iridium and ICO were great opportunities, and he would spend the next couple of years trying to acquire these two companies. At one point, he would even invest $74.6 million into Iridium to keep it afloat. Clearly, the other investors of Teledesic weren't thrilled to see McCall focusing on keeping these random companies alive instead of focusing on Teledesic. This would even lead to an investor filing a lawsuit against McCall for using Teledesic's resources to aid in his personal interest in ICO. Things were falling apart rapidly, and Teledesic was yet to even launch a single satellite. And when you think that things can't get worse, the dot-com crash would happen. Investors were losing millions of dollars left and right during the dot-com crash, and they had no intention of continuing to fund Teledesic. Meanwhile, Bill Gates had just stepped down from his role as Microsoft CEO, and he was looking to focus on philanthropy. So, he really didn't have that much interest in trying to save the company, either. Fortunately though, Teledesic had not yet locked in on a satellite contract with any company. They did originally work with Boeing, but then they switched to Motorola, and eventually they switched to Thales Alenia Space. Ironically, their constant switching would turn out to be a good thing. Since they hadn't locked into a contract with any of these companies, they actually still had a lot of the cash they raised. Considering this unique situation, investors would decide to pull the plug when they still could. And given the structure in which money is raised for startups, early investors would actually end up profiting from their investment, despite the company not doing anything. Late investors, however, would lose money, but even those losses were quite minimal, especially compared to many companies that closed down during the dot-com crash. At the end of the day, Teledesic aimed to revolutionize global internet, but honestly, it was just way too early, as in, decades too early. Combine this with the fact that Teledesic didn't have launch capability in-house, and the fact that Teledesic was more of a side project for McCall and Gates, it's not hard to see why the project never worked out. It is, however, insane to think that these two geniuses had the idea to basically launch Starlink 30 years ago. Did you guys know about Teledesic? Comment that down below. Also, drop a like if you guys are confident that Starlink will have a much better fate. And of course, consider joining our Discord community to suggest future video ideas, and consider subscribing to see more questions logically answered. But until then, I'm Hari. I'll see you guys on the next one.